Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions. We start with question number one from Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it measures economic performance.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The Scottish Government uses the National Performance Framework and Scotland Performs to help monitor and assess Scotland's overall economic performance. These contain indicators that assess Scotland's performance across a number of dimensions, including economic growth, productivity and participation in the labour market. The Scottish Government is committed to improving Scotland's economic performance. Scotland's economic strategy sets out our framework for doing so, and it's based on the twin objectives of boosting competitiveness whilst tackling inequality.
Annie Wells.
In its latest Scotland Performs document, published alongside the draft budget, the Scottish Government was found to be stagnating or actually getting worse in 46 out of the 67 key indicators it sets itself. Does the Minister consider this to be a success? And if not, can the Minister explain to the Chamber the reasons for the abysmal performance?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's nice to hear the Conservatives talking so positively about Scotland's economy, as always. Annie Wells could have pointed out that the employment rate of 73.6% for quarter 3 2016 is the second highest across all UK countries. It could have pointed out that total income received by Scottish households increased over this period. The ratio of income to the top 10% compared to the bottom 40% increased from 112 to 115. Or could have pointed out that the gender pay gap was 6.2%, a decrease of 1.48 percentage points. Or even that the value of Scottish exports had increased by 3.6% on 2014. That is an increase of 4.4% in relation to exports to the rest of the UK, and also 4.4% in relation to exports to the rest of the EU, as well as a 3.4% increase elsewhere. These are very positive measures. There are other measures which I acknowledge are challenging, but I think it's only fair to recognise two important facts. One, that there are positive measures here, and secondly, there is another government active in the economy in Scotland. And we've heard for a long time from the Conservatives, oh, we are getting new powers, so you must use this. The UK government had those powers before. What did they do with them?
Jackie Bailey.
Let me focus on one such target that the Scottish government has adapted. One is that productivity should move from the third quartile to the first quartile by 2017 compared to other OECD countries. I understand that that target has been missed. We remain in the third quartile and have fallen from 18th to 19th place. Why has the Scottish Government failed to meet this target?
Cabinet Secretary.
Perfectly true, as Jackie Bailey says, that we've remained in the third quartile, not gone into the first quartile. I've mentioned that a number of times in this chamber, not least in relation to the review that we're currently conducting in terms of our enterprise and skills organisations. But it would have been useful had Jackie Bailey acknowledged there has been a 4.4% increase in productivity in Scotland. There's been none whatsoever in the rest of the UK. It is not good enough. And what we have to do in that circumstance is look at what we're currently doing, which is exactly what we're doing in terms of the review of enterprise and skills agencies, but also in relation to the £500 million Scottish Growth Scheme, which will help to drive increased productivity, competitiveness and internationalisation.
Question number two, Ben Macpherson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to assist marine energy developers.
Minister Paul Quillows.
The Scottish Government and its enterprise agencies continue to offer significant support to the marine energy sector in Scotland. The Renewable Energy Investment Fund and Wave Energy Scotland initiatives alone have so far provided £57 million to wave and tidal projects. The decision by the UK Government in November 2016 that it would not be providing ring-fence support for wave and tidal technologies in the second Contracts for Difference allocation round came as a blow to many marine energy developers. Following the announcement, I convened a roundtable discussion with industry representatives and UK government officials to understand industry priorities. I reiterated the Scottish Government's strong commitment to development of a successful marine energy industry and to maintaining our current global lead. Scottish ministers will continue to use the powers we have to support the growth of the sector, and we're willing to work with the UK Government and industry to explore possible solutions. I propose that Scotland hosts a new working group to replace the UK Government's defunct Marine Energy Programme Board in order to find a way forward. And work is currently underway to agree the remit, membership and terms of reference of that new group.
Ben Macpherson.
I thank the Minister for that answer and share his concerns about the UK Government's CFD allocations. The Minister is aware of Nova Innovation in my constituency, and I wonder if the Minister could update me on what assistance the Scottish Government is providing to find a site for the deployment of Nova Innovation's next phase of world-leading tidal energy devices, which will provide numerous employment opportunities as well as significantly contribute towards a low-carbon economy by 2050.
Minister.
Well, first thing I should say is I certainly recognise Nova Innovation are a very forward-thinking company. They've done excellent work of late. They've had a very successful year. I understand the technical parameters of the site that Nova Innovation are looking for, and for reasons of commercial confidentiality, I won't go into detail here. But there is an enhanced account team approach being used to engage with Nova Innovation, pulling together SE Company Growth, Reef, Highlands Isles Enterprise and Waters team perspectives. There is a proposal by SE and High to review all available sites in Scotland that can accommodate wave and tidal projects up to 2022 to include currently owned sites and potential smaller scale community sites. And a meeting was arranged with officials to discuss this with the Crown Estate on the 1st of February, but due to illness to one of those who was due to attend, this is now going to take place next Monday, the 13th of February.
Boris Golden.
Scottish Enterprise lost more than £30 million of public funding when two wave power companies went into liquidation. What steps is the SNP government taking to ensure that lessons are learned from this and that investment in wave power delivers good value for money?
Yes, sir.
Well, I do think it's somewhat rich of Maurice Golden, and I do recognise his genuine interest in these issues, but I would say to him very gently that the UK Government is responsible for some of the perilous conditions that the wave energy sector has faced in Scotland. And if he is sincere about his wishes, and I believe he is, then he needs to make representations to UK ministers, to Greg Clark, to follow up the Scottish Government's lead on this in urging Mr Clark to provide a route to market and support, sincere support for our wave and tidal energies. It is only the Scottish Government that is stepping in to help this industry at the moment. The UK Government is doing next to nothing to support a vital industry for our islands.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I echo much of the sentiment expressed there by the Minister and ask whether in relation to supporting innovation there has been any progress in discussions with the UK Government about setting a CFD pot for innovation, including wave and tidal, but perhaps other storage technologies that I think could benefit from that sort of support at this critical time.
Minister.
Well, I certainly thank Lee MacArthur for his question. I know he has a very strong and long-standing interest in this issue, which affects his constituency very severely. What I would say is that we are in continued dialogue with BEIS and UK government ministers on this issue. We are going to look to see if there are any opportunities arising out of the UK industrial strategy to see, given one of the challenge pots relates to energy projects, and we clearly see that the centres of excellence such as EMEC are world-leading, and therefore we would hope that UK government ministers will support a strong bid from the Scottish industry for funding for innovation in this sector. So we live in hope that we will see some form of support for wave and tidal technologies going forward, but that will depend, of course, on the decisions made by UK ministers.
Question number three, Bill Bowman.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it can offer the employees of NCR in Dundee who are facing potential redundancy.
Minister, Bob Wheelhouse.
I understand NCR has commenced consultation with its employees regarding the company's future restructuring plans. We have contacted NCR to offer support for any employees who may be facing redundancy through our Partnership Action for Continuing Employment, or PACE initiative, and the company has stated it will make contact to discuss PACE support depending on the outcome of the consultation. I would not want to prejudge, of course, that consultation. Through providing skills development and employability support, PACE aims to minimise the time individuals affected by redundancy are out of work, and PACE has an excellent record in achieving positive outcomes for those affected by redundancy. Scottish Enterprise, as the member would expect, stand ready to work with NCR management to safeguard employment at the Dundee site.
Bill Bowman.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Over the last few weeks, news of other redundancies and relocations in Dundee have been reported. It is a worrying time for those concerned. What support can the Scottish Government offer the City of Dundee to help boost job creation following yesterday's news that the city has the lowest employment rate of any city in the UK?
Minister.
Well, companies such as NCR and indeed others such as Tokheim and Dundee and Michelin have been real success stories for the city, and we of course have been providing funding support through the account management process that we have with Scottish Enterprise with key employers in Dundee to make sure we've got targeted help for companies as they grow or try and take on new market challenges. So I certainly assure the member and others who've got an interest in the economy of Dundee that the Scottish Government is very sincere about providing support to key employers in that area. And of course, whether it's skills support or support for export development of the kind that the Cabinet Secretary outlined in his earlier answer around the Scottish Growth Scheme, we always look to try and support companies in the local economy like Dundee to succeed and thrive. But take these matters very seriously, and of course, if there are examples that do arise, PACE and other wider Scottish Government family of enterprise and skills agencies are there to intervene and help.
Question number four, Graeme Dey.
Thank you. Yeah, to ask the Scottish Government how Angus will benefit from the Tay Cities deal.
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, I would want to say how delighted I am at the strategic partnership working across these four councils, which is clearly reflected in the Tay Cities Region Deal proposal. Just last week, I had the opportunity to meet the Chief Executive of Angus Council and others to hear firsthand about their emerging City Region Deal proposals. I also had the pleasure of hearing how Angus see their role in contributing to and benefiting from sustainable, inclusive economic growth through this collaborative approach.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. He'll be aware of proposals within the City Deal to establish an East of Scotland hub of the National Manufacturing Institute of Scotland in Arbroath. The aim of this is to increase investment, innovation, encourage greater internationalisation of Angus and Tayside's engineering and advanced manufacturing sector, upskill the existing workforce and create more apprenticeships. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would agree with me that this has the potential to give the town and the wider region a very significant economic boost and is worthy indeed of pursuing.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think there were some very interesting proposals, not least in terms of the life sciences, the relationship with Dundee University, the success they've had there and other interests in Angus. But in relation to the proposals generally, they're very much in harmony with the developing proposals for the National Manufacturing Institute for Scotland. It's a significant proposal in MIS with the potential to support step changes in the efficiency and productivity of Scotland's manufacturing sector. However, decisions on its establishment and location will depend on the business case, which will be published later this year. And wherever the constituent parts of the institute are located, we are determined it will be for the benefit of the whole of Scotland.
Jenny Gilruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how Midfife and Glenrothes will benefit from the Tay and the Edinburgh City deals, respectively.
Cabinet Secretary.
Jenny Gilruth's question highlights a very unusual point in as far as Fife Council, of course, are partners in two different potential city deals. So we've been very clear that they are welcome regional partners working together on long-term strategic proposals which seek to deliver inclusive economic growth. So for Midfife and Glenrothes, it's natural that they should look both to Edinburgh and to Dundee as major centres of employment. We are very comfortable to see Fife working as part of both those city regions as proposals are developed.
Question 5 has not been lodged. Question 6, and ask Sarwar.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recently published report, Export Statistics Scotland 2015.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government very much welcomes the latest export figures for Scotland. They show that despite challenging times for the global economy and excluding oil and gas, our total international exports increased by £1 billion in 1 year. We are working with our partners to deliver Scotland's trade and investment strategy in order to further improve our exporting performance and to ensure that we're seen to be an outward-facing nation that's open for business.
And that's Sarwar.
Do you hear that the Minister accepts the and welcomes the findings of the Export Statistics Scotland, which also finds that 63% of Scotland's exports go to the rest of the United Kingdom and 16% of Scotland's exports go to other parts of the European Union. Can the Minister therefore explain his economic incoherence on why he believes a reaction to leaving the EU single market is to have another referendum and attempt to leave the biggest and most important market for Scotland, which is the United Kingdom, which is four times the size? Doesn't this expose that it's not economic coherence that the Minister is looking for, but is grudge, grievance and leaving the United Kingdom?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the applause from the Conservative benches tells its own story. And of course, yesterday we saw political incoherence in as far as the Labour Party had three of their own members voting for that withdrawal from the EU market. I don't know why Anas Sarwar wants to support that withdrawal from the EU market. We don't believe we should withdraw from the EU market. We think it's an extremely important market, eight times the size of the UK market. But we also believe we should continue and expand our growth with the rest rest of the UK. And interestingly, for the rest of the UK, of course, they export more into Scotland than we do to the rest of the UK, an extremely important market. It's only a fool that would want to see that made as a choice. We think we should continue to export to both. We should increase our exports. Our efforts are actually, as I've mentioned in response to Jackie Bailey's question, designed towards achieving further exports. Why anybody would want, what the motivation is for somebody to promote or talk up a trade war between Scotland and the UK, I'll leave to the economic incoherence of Anas Sarwar. We want to trade with everybody and do more of it.
Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I remind the Chamber of my role as a Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary for the economy. For Scotland's economy to thrive and prosper, we need to grow exports to all our markets. Anyone who presents a false choice between exporting to the UK market as an alternative to the EU market fails to understand business or politics and does a great disservice to Scottish business through their lack of ambition for our economy. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the proposals contained in Scottish Government's document, Scotland's Place in Europe, enables Scotland to continue to trade with both the UK and the EU single market on the same terms as today, and offers businesses in the rest of the UK the opportunity to trade with the EU on favourable terms by basing themselves in Scotland? A win-win for all concerned.
If the Cabinet Secretary heard the question...
Can I say, first of all, Presiding Officer, that it is really refreshing to hear members diligently record their interests when they're speaking, a lesson that could be learned by others in this chamber as well. And I'd also reject any suggestion, as Ivan McKee's question does, any suggestion that Scotland should face a choice between trading with the rest of the UK. I mean, the preposterous nature of the Conservative position, which is we want to, Theresa May said exactly this, we want to trade more with everybody. But in certain circumstances, we're not going to trade with Scotland. You know, a nonsense that the Labour Party, unfortunately, has bought into. An absolute nonsense. There is no reason why Scotland should not increase its exports, as it's been doing. A 4.4% increase in relation to the rest of the UK, the same increase into the rest of the EU. You think they would want to recommend and welcome that, but instead, what we've got, the same old thing, talking Scotland down. We will continue to promote Scotland and to increase exports, and they can talk Scotland down.
Jean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In yesterday's debate, the Scottish Government told us that there will be a hard Brexit, resulting in a customs border between the UK and the EU. If that is true, what side of that customs border does Mr Brown want Scotland to be on? Does he want it to be on the UK domestic market side, which accounts for two-thirds of our domestic trade, or on the European side, which accounts for 16% of our exports? He cannot have both, based on his own analysis of there being a customs border. He cannot have both, and based on the feedback from EU senior officials of the EU, he cannot have both. So which one is it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, can I suggest, if that is the message of the Conservative Party, you cannot have both. If that is the message of the Conservative, could you at least be honest with the people of Ireland and Northern Ireland? Because that's not what you're saying to them. You're saying explicitly, you're saying they can have both. So what is so different about the island of Ireland and Northern Ireland, about Scotland? Of course it's the case, we can have both. We would prefer, of course, and we have said this, we think the UK should stay in the single market. If they don't want to do that, that has to be their decision. We want to stay in the single market. It's only the Tories that are talking about erecting borders. Theresa May herself has said, we want to buy your goods, we want to sell yours, we want to trade with you as freely as possible and work with one another to make sure we are all safer, more secure and more prosperous. The Scottish Government is looking after the interests of the people of Scotland in doing that, and I suggest the Scottish Tories could learn a lesson and do the same thing as well.
Question 7 wasn't lodged. Question 8, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee's report on the economic impact of leaving the EU.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government welcomes the committee's report on the economic impact of leaving the EU, and in particular notes its recommendations and conclusions. We've been clear about the risks that Brexit poses to the economy. That's why in recent months we have announced steps to invest an additional £100 million in capital projects in this financial year to help stimulate growth. We're also establishing a new £500 million Scottish growth scheme to support, in particular, small and medium enterprises and taking forward a range of measures through the budget. The Scottish Government has always been clear that remaining in Europe is the best option for our future. In December, we published a detailed set of proposals in Scotland's Place in Europe, our plan for dealing with the consequences of Brexit. And that plan outlines our proposal that, first and foremost, the UK government should negotiate for the UK as a whole to retain single market membership. But that if the UK government will not do this, as indeed the Prime Minister has indicated, then we urge the UK government to put forward a differentiated approach so that Scotland can stay within the EU.
John Mason.
Thank you for that answer. I mean, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary noticed in the report the concern of the committee reflecting a lot of witnesses we had about the danger if EU workers are not any longer able to come and work. And we, in fact, heard from Walker's Shortbread, Angus Soft Fruits, Denham Seafoods, Scottish Leather Group, Scottish Engineering, Scottish Care, all of whom were concerned about not having workers from the EU.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I am very concerned about that, and I would suggest that there are other sectors in addition to those which John Mason has mentioned. I had a meeting earlier on today with a number of substantial insurance companies very concerned about this, and of course the higher education sector is very concerned. So the 181,000 EU citizens who've chosen to make their home in Scotland enrich our culture, but they also strengthen our society and boost our economy. And as the committee's report makes clear, these workers make a vital contribution across a range of sectors. That's why the Scottish Government is exploring all possible avenues for Scotland to retain the benefits of EU membership, for which Scotland voted. The Scottish Parliament's European and External Affairs Committees also noted the important contribution of EU migrants to Scotland and has called for Scotland to be allowed its own separate immigration deal after Brexit. And at the very least, can the UK government, can the Conservative Party in this place not at least say that all EU citizens in Scotland should be given the guarantee that their place in Scotland is secure?
Briefly, Richard Leonard.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. When he gave evidence to the committee, the Cabinet Secretary said, "We have responded to the situation, but we have not changed the economic strategy." The committee's unanimous finding in para 147 of the report is that in light of the evidence heard on the changing economic landscape following the decision to leave the EU, we recommend that the Scottish Government's economic strategy should be reviewed. So will he now institute a review of his government's economic strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
What Richard Leonard neglects to mention, which I also said at the committee, is of course the actions that we take and the initiatives that we're involved in have to respond to the changing circumstance. But I think an economic strategy which seeks to promote inclusive and sustainable growth is the right one for Scotland. And of course that was examined during the course of the Enterprise and Skills Review. So of course, as we're doing in terms of doubling the number of SDI representatives across the EU, increasing the number of offices that we have, increasing the trade promotion activity that we do, not least through the establishment of a Board of Trade, of course we will respond differently to the circumstances, but the economic strategy is the right one.
We move now to finance and constitution questions. Start with question number one from Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take to support businesses that will see their non-domestic rates bills rise increase from April 2017.
Cabinet Secretary Derek Mackay.
The Scottish Government has set out a highly competitive non-domestic rates package as part of the 2017-18 budget. This includes reducing the rates poundage by 3.7% to 46.6 pence, expanding the small business bonus scheme so that it lifts 100,000 properties out of rates altogether, and raising the threshold for the large business supplement so that fewer than 10% of properties pay it. And we're not insisting on a revenue-neutral revaluation, which would have meant setting a higher poundage, and we're not proposing a nationwide transitional relief scheme, as such a scheme would mean many smaller businesses funding reductions for a few large utility companies. However, councils can use the powers granted through the Community Empowerment Act to apply further rates reductions locally, separate from the government-funded reliefs I've just touched upon.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In other parts of the UK, governments are putting in place transitional measures to support companies who are seeing their rates bills rise. But the Cabinet Secretary won't do the same for Scotland, and calling transitional arrangements a blunt instrument just in committee this morning. But that will come as no help to the city nursery in my constituency, whose rates bill, whose rates valuation will go from £38,000 to £64,000, with costs likely to be passed on to parents, resulting in increasing childcare costs. Indeed, for nurseries across Edinburgh, bills are set to rise by 64%, including 38 nurseries whose bills will more than double. So will he rethink his approach on transitional relief?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think this is a very important issue, and I think it's a fair question that's put, raising individual circumstances, but I do believe it has to be put into context to understand why a transitional rates relief scheme, I don't believe it is appropriate. So if I can cover the detail of this very important issue, of course the decisions by assessors are independent, and such a rating evaluation will have been independent of government. Some values will have increased, some will have decreased, and of course those who see an increase have that ability to appeal. It would be wrong to suggest that we're increasing business rates. We're not. We're actually reducing business rates by some 3.7%. By not insisting on a revenue neutral revaluation, that, if I had insisted on an increase essentially, it would have meant higher bills. But taking together all the decisions around the changes to small business bonus, large business supplement and the poundage, that's the government foregoing £155 million that we could have received if I didn't take those decisions. Put further in context, the national package of rates relief, that's £600 million. Specifically on transitional rates relief, I say again that if we had gone ahead with a transitional relief scheme, which is automatic south of the border, it's a government choice, but it's automatic south of the border, what it would have meant is that many, many businesses across Scotland would be paying artificially higher business rates to compensate others, mainly big utility companies and some others as well. But I felt that the balance is a fair and a proportionate one to ensure that many businesses who are entitled to the rates relief and the rates going down actually see that happen, because over 70% of Scottish properties will pay the same or less as a consequence of our decisions than they do currently. So in addition to all those national reliefs that I've described, we also have the Ken Barclay review to look at all the issues in relation to business rates, and I'm very interested in the methodology of some of the determinations around that. But the reason I identify the Community Empowerment Act is I think it is right that in local circumstances, councils do feel empowered through the Community Empowerment Act. Perth and Kinross has already used the power, and they now have additional resources coming from the Stage 1 budget to be able to apply local reliefs that might be right for local circumstances, but I'll continue to engage with business. I apologise for the length of that answer, Presiding Officer, but I do believe this is a very important and fair question to have been put, and I think businesses should hear of some of the support that's available to them to try and help them through, for some of them, what will be quite a difficult time. But when set in context, I think all members can see why I've arrived at the decisions that I have.
Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me how many more businesses will benefit from different forms of rates relief this year compared to last year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I touched upon in my detailed answer, more than half of all businesses will pay no rates whatsoever, and over 100,000 businesses for the first time will be exempt from business rates as a consequence of the small business bonus. And further on the large business supplement, 8,000 businesses will be taken out of that rate as a consequence of our changing of the threshold to the figure of £51,000.
Ross Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to declare an interest as a current and serving councillor in Aberdeen City Council. Given that the First Minister has refused to meet with council leaders and businesses in Aberdeen today, can the Cabinet Secretary update the Chamber on the discussions he has had with Aberdeen City Council, as well as the Spotlight Group, who have raised the serious concerns of local businesses about the damage that will be caused to the regional economy by the rise in business rates?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I hope that Ross Thompson, in fairness, reflects on the information that I've just given the Chamber on the national situation, and absolutely engaged with Aberdeen City and Shire and the Chamber of Commerce for what was described as a fiery meeting. It was actually a very constructive and helpful meeting. What businesses in the region asked us to do was for Scottish Government and local authorities to work together on this issue, and that's absolutely what I've done. And I've worked across party lines as well, engaged with the administration of Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire councils to explain the national situation, share information, as I've just covered, but also empower them and give them the support that they require to be able to design an appropriate local relief scheme as well. And they've received that very positively. You know, let's set aside the political point scoring. There's an opportunity, a window of opportunity, to work together to have an adequate scheme in place in advance of the financial year. Now, I'm quite confident that both councils are working on such a scheme. But my latest understanding is that Aberdeenshire may well be able to provide that before the city, but both councils, I am advised, are working on it.
Lee MacArthur.
Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary may have seen the announcement from Scottish Renewables that a number of small renewables projects are set to see rate rises of up to 650%, putting into doubt the future investment in a number of smaller hydro, wind and solar projects. Can I get an assurance from the Cabinet Secretary he's discussing with his ministerial colleague Paul Wheelhouse that this sort of rate rise is not cutting across the objectives we all want to see in delivering on the climate change plan and indeed on the energy strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I accept the point, and whilst there has been an expansion of rural rates relief as well, small business bonus, and there's also advantages around community ownership, absolutely the Business Minister and myself continue to discuss and engage on this specific issue, and I'm interested again on how local schemes, relief schemes may be able to be deployed to help individual projects. So absolutely all of that is still under active consideration.
Question number two, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much additional funding it will provide to North Ayrshire Council in 2017-18 to improve educational attainment.
Cabinet Secretary.
North Ayrshire is one of nine Scottish Attainment Challenge authorities and received over £3.5 million for 16-17 to deliver an authority-wide plan focused on improving literacy, numeracy and health and wellbeing across our primary and secondary schools. Scottish Attainment Challenge authority plans for 17-18 will be commissioned this month and funding decisions will be made following a formal review process of these plans. Additionally, as the Deputy First Minister announced last week, in 2017-18, schools in North Ayrshire will directly receive a total of £4,392,000 through the Pupil Equity Fund.
Ken Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Does he agree that these additional resources will give head teachers greater flexibility to help improve the literacy, numeracy, health and wellbeing for pupils, particularly in some of our most deprived communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely do. And some people criticise the government for our departure and giving resources direct to head teachers and to schools, but I think that it's a very welcome transformation and should help us address the poverty-related attainment gap.
Question number three, Jenny Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on waiving debt that is owed to it by public bodies in financial crisis.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government sets out in the Scottish Public Finance Manual the conditions where lending money is appropriate and also the factors to be taken into account when considering the waiving of debts. The key consideration for the Scottish Government is always the economic, efficient and effective stewardship of taxpayers' money.
The Cabinet Secretary will know that NHS Tayside have said that their debt due to the Scottish Government this year will total £36 million. Can the Cabinet Secretary please tell Parliament if NHS Tayside is the only NHS board in debt to the government? If this is the largest debt, what the implications are of waiving the debt and is if his government might consider this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, what I can say to Jenny Mara is NHS Tayside, like any public body, has an obligation to live within its means and we expect the board to take action to do so. There is brokerage arrangements in place and repayment of brokerage will be agreed over the lifetime and a timeline that supports the stability for NHS Tayside and is fairly consistent across the NHS in Scotland.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. NHS Tayside have admitted they need to find £214 million in savings over the next 5 years just to break even. What assurance can the Cabinet Secretary give my constituents that they will not see any diminution in frontline services due to the desperate financial situation that has been allowed to develop in NHS Tayside?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Murdo Fraser might want to tell his constituents that he voted against more money for the health services he was trying to secure. Tax cuts for the rich, including reintroducing prescription charges, all at the same time as this government's investing in the NHS frontline services, as well as enhancing the support for social care GPs and other professionals as well. But we'll engage with NHS Tayside, as you would expect, to ensure that they're in a strong position and we can give them support to get through this period.
Question number four, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution last spoke with the Scottish Fiscal Commission.
Cabinet Secretary.
I held a meeting with Lady Rice, the Chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and Commissioner Campbell Leaf on the 9th of December 2016, at which the Commission presented the findings of its scrutiny of the forecast underpinning the Scottish Government's draft budget for 2017-18. In addition, I spoke to Lady Rice by telephone on Friday, 27th of January this year.
Monica Lennon.
thank the Cabinet Secretary for his reply. This week, the Fraser of Islander Institute raised concerns about the way in which the so-called additional money announced in last week's budget was found in such a short period of time after the draft budget, and raised some important issues about the overall budget process and options for reform. Mm. Following the regulations to expand the functions of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, which are due to come into force in April 2017, what assurances can the Cabinet Secretary give that Parliament will receive forecasts in sufficient time to ensure members can provide proper scrutiny to future budget processes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I actually agree that we need to review the processes of the Parliament, and that's why I absolutely supported the Budget Review Group. I think there's a number of processes that are worthy of revision, partly because of how the functions of the Parliament have changed, the new powers, the timescales coming from the Chancellor's statements as well. The budget process is undoubtedly complex. I think all members recognise that, and we should all reflect on that together. But the Scottish Fiscal Commission have certainly confirmed to me that the assessments that we've made are reasonable to inform our budget position, and they certainly haven't complained to me about lack of time to do their work, and I look forward to moving into their statutory function this year. But I say again, I'm embracing the review with an open mind. I think all members should do that as well, so that we can arrive at a better process for our budget, and I'm happy to engage with political parties on that.
Question 5, Ruth McGuire.
To ask the Scottish Government how many businesses will receive support from the expansion of the Small Business Bonus Scheme.
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've mentioned earlier, over 100,000 properties will be lifted out of non-domestic rates for 2017-18 due to the expansion of the Small Business Bonus Scheme.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Could he share with Parliament what other policies are in place to give SMEs a competitive advantage?
Secretary. The Economy Secretary has mentioned the Scottish Growth Scheme, but there's also further advice and support, improved access to finance, help for exports and support around innovation and entrepreneurship as well. And there's also the prospect of the Workforce Development Fund that Mr Hepburn is taking forward.
Jackie Bailey.
For those not in the Small Business Bonus Scheme, times are indeed tough. England and Wales have transitional relief schemes. Scotland used to have a transitional relief scheme for every previous revaluation. And contrary to what the Cabinet Secretary said, it's not just utilities that are affected. We've heard of nurseries, tourism businesses, hotels in my constituency that will need to pay off staff. If we bring him examples where there is a real impact, can I urge the Cabinet Secretary to consider transitional relief?
Cabinet Secretary.
I really do hate to embarrass Jackie Bailey by pointing out her inaccuracies, but actually last time there was a revaluation, there wasn't a transitional rates relief scheme either because of the assessment around who would be the winners and the losers. Well, you weren't factually correct, and you can keep heckling me if you like, Jackie Bailey, but essentially your question was, if you bring me further information, will I look at options? Of course I will. I'm a very engaging Cabinet Secretary. I like working with people. I like working with people to find solutions. And my solutions nationally involve lowering the poundage, expanding small business bonus, taking more people out of the large business supplement, advising people how to appeal if that's the appropriate thing to do, reducing the tax take because of not insisting on a revenue neutral revaluation, and supporting local authorities to implement local rates relief schemes where that is appropriate. But I would say to Jackie Bailey and a number of Labour authorities around the country, you should look seriously, the extra resources that local authorities now have, the empowerment and the enablement that exists, and if it is appropriate to have a further local rates relief scheme, that you implement that rather than simply carping from the sidelines. You have a responsibility. You should take that responsibility, as I have done nationally, to support businesses. And if we had just implemented, a national transitional rates relief scheme, it would have meant many people's bills been held artificially high to pay for others, particularly the big utility firms. I really do think that the opposition need to know their facts on this very significant matter.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Small Business Bonus Scheme is particularly valuable in rural areas where there are more small and medium-sized businesses. Can the Finance Secretary explain what impact the rural rates relief could have in Dumfries and Galloway?
So as well as the range of reliefs that I've touched upon, what I wanted to do is make sure that we were able to match what was happening south of the border in terms of rural rates relief as well, so that we can catch as many as possible to give maximum support. And that was the intention of matching rural rates relief as it relates to the position south of the border. But it really does put us in a position where, particularly for smaller businesses, that we have the most competitive rates relief regime across these islands.
Question six, Richard Lockhead.
Can I ask the Scottish Government how rural deprivation is taking into account in its funding allocations?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recognises the importance of delivering services for rural areas, which is clearly reflected as a priority within the programme for government. In particular, indicators used for the allocation of funding to NHS boards and local authorities take account of rural deprivation. For example, morbidity and life circumstances is a component of the formula used for allocating funding to NHS boards. And this component adjusts for deprivation. It is calculated for small area populations of between 500 and 1,000 residents and is therefore able to identify pockets of deprivation in rural as well as urban areas. The formula also takes account of the higher cost of delivering services in rural and remote areas.
Richard Lockhead.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, and I commend the additional focus on tackling poverty and inequalities in Scotland, issues which have been exacerbated by Tory government policy, according to the recent Resolution Foundation report just last week. But he is aware that rural deprivation can be quite challenging to identify, and I know that there's an increased targeting by the Scottish Government on the data zones in the top 15% of areas identified under the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation. Areas like Moray do not qualify in the top 15% as do other areas in Scotland. Therefore, can I have an assurance there is a safety mechanism in place that does identify rural deprivation, which is difficult to measure and identify at times, but must absolutely be supported in the same way that other communities are as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I do believe there are such mechanisms and safeguards, such as through the local government finance methodology. And also, if you take the attainment fund on a school basis, the coverage of that fund to tackle inequality has reached every local authority in Scotland.
Okay, Douglas Ross.
Presiding Officer, Audit Scotland have reported in the past that many people living in Moray are classified as being deprived in terms of their ability to access services. What is the Scottish Government doing to address that issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think eligibility is a very fair point. There was a time pre this administration when funds were targeted on an area by area basis on postcode and just areas of multiple deprivation, so you could actually be poor and potentially eligible but live in the wrong areas to get support and access for services. Now, we changed that in many of our funding streams to target more support based on your eligibility, i.e. are you actually less well off? Should you be entitled to services rather than living in a certain postcode? And I think that's a good practical example of how governments change policy to actually genuinely target need rather than just a data zone approach. It has to be a balance of targeted interventions and universality where eligibility is taken into account.
Thank you, and that concludes portfolio questions. Oh, point of order, Jenny Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary may consider himself engaging, but he failed miserably to engage with any of the four brief points in my supplementary question. Presiding Officer, I'd like to ask your advice on what is the point of supplementary questions in Parliament if the Minister simply answers again the question that was tabled. If I can remind Derek Mackay, my questions were, is NHS Tayside's debt to the Scottish Government the largest debt? What are the implications of waiving the debt? Will his government consider doing this? And is it the only board in Scotland that has such a debt to the Scottish Government? If the Cabinet Secretary can't answer this question in Parliament, maybe he'll be kind enough to write to me and engage with the points then.
Thank you, Ms. Mara. That's not a point of order. However, she has made her point, and I'm sure she's perfectly capable of putting down written questions or putting them in a letter to the Minister, who will consider them. We're now going to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate in the name of Jamie Hepburn on Job Centre Plus. Just take a few seconds to change seats.